All right, welcome in everybody. Thank you all for joining today's webinar. It's an introduction to GitLab today. This is for teams getting started with GitLab. I'm joined by my colleague here, Steve Graham, who's a member of the Customer Success Engineering team. And my name is Chris Gattarte. I'm a Senior Customer Success Engineer here at GitLab. So today we'll be going over the basics of GitLab in today's introductory webinar. And today's webinar will cover foundational concepts and usage of GitLab, how things are organized, the terminology, navigating the user interface, and the fundamentals for tracking work. Additionally, I'll share the recommended GitLab flow for feature branch development. Please look out for these additional topics that we'll be covering in upcoming webinars this month. We'll be going over intro to CI/CD, advanced CI/CD, as well as security and compliance within GitLab. We also offer some adoption workshops that are more hands-on types of overviews, as well as giving you an opportunity to work hands-on within a sandbox environment on the GitLab.com SaaS platform. So we do have a registration link on our webinars calendar page on our handbook, just the same way that you found our intro to GitLab webinar today. So please take a look for the most up-to-date list of upcoming webinars and workshops, and we'd love to have you in our future sessions. All right, to set the context, I want to make sure that I share that we believe that in a world where software defines the speed of innovation, you have to be great at developing, securing, and deploying software. Companies must be expert at all three, or they'll be disrupted by those who are. In our current economic climate, they need to undergo these digital transformations while also cutting costs, being more efficient, and doing more with less. And so clearly, these organizations face challenges as they undergo digital and business transformation. Our customers are trying to make a big transition. They're going from project-driven, ticket-based development to product-driven, value-based delivery. We see these challenges emerging as a result of changes in people, process, and technology. Product teams and developer teams are trying to accelerate the time to market so that they can quickly show customer value. At the same time, product teams face too many handoffs, broken feedback loops, and limited visibility. Meanwhile, developers have more responsibilities as companies embrace a shift-left development culture. And finally, we see the emergence of platform teams who are tasked with scaling self-service tools for developers while implementing effective security and cost-cutting safeguards, all of which is challenging with today's hybrid work styles and disconnected tool change. So the second challenge that we're faced is toolchain sprawl, what we call do-it-yourself DevOps. So IT executives and managers are seeing the costs and inefficiencies that are inherent in the patchwork point solution approach. This approach leads to unwieldy, ungovernable, and costly toolchain sprawl, especially as there are more and more applications and tools to integrate. This introduces complexity at multiple levels. Imagine a scenario where one app in the toolchain needs to be updated. In theory, all integrations of that application need to be retested every time there's an update. But many companies find that they need to cut corners and as a result, do not update their applications and lead you to potentially facing a vulnerability with an unupdated application. The result is, again, as I mentioned, find yourself exposed to those vulnerabilities because they can't incorporate those security fixes fast enough with that DIY DevOps approach. Another example is in data and visibility. Executive teams and individual contributors all rely on visibility to solve significant business and technology challenges. And yet, leaders struggle to get end-to-end visibility. The data behind point solutions is difficult to extract in a meaningful way. It may even violate a contractual agreement by trying to extract the data for purposes of creating new products internally. Many customers are limited to a subset of that data that the vendor that you're using for that specific point solution provide through an API. Put it more simply, you might be flying without any instrumentation across all of your DevOps platform. And so the toolchain sprawl is really the enemy of transformation. So here comes with GitLab. So we've got the most comprehensive enterprise DevSecOps platform. GitLab is a solution that organizations are looking to empower development teams, security teams, and operations teams to build better security, better software faster. We give teams better insights, greater efficiency, improved collaboration, and faster time to value. By uniquely creating this offering as a single application, we're best able to provide our customers with end-to-end visibility across the software delivery lifecycle. And in a single application, GitLab provides all the functionality of a complete DevSecOps platform. We allow organizations to deliver software faster while strengthening security and compliance, thereby maximizing your return on software development. So here I've got an example of the GitLab flow. We've got one workflow to unite your developers, security, and operations team. To make it more concrete, let's look at this, starting with the planning stage and creating the software, to integrating and verifying software, to deploying and operating software, and finally monitoring, and then improving software through further iterations. So each of these steps brings in different stakeholders and teams in your company, where everyone plays a role, even when security and operations shift left. So with this solution, we help customers proactively identify vulnerabilities by integrating and automating vulnerability management within development lifecycle. So you can see within our automated test process on the feature branch. So you can imagine that this bottom line here is the master or main or default branch. Then we've got this line that goes above, every time a developer wants to propose changes that needs to be merged into that default or main branch, for example, that create that merge request, and it runs the automated pipeline and automated tests, which can include those automated security tests that are included as part of our platform. So with that capability, we help those customers proactively identify vulnerabilities by integrating and automating that security test process, as well as the vulnerability management that could happen directly within the merge request, identifying vulnerabilities before they're actually merged into the default branch. And then from there, you can actually create issues based on the work that's being done on that development branch. So those issues can be identified, logged, triaged, tracked, and remediated all in the same application within the same DevSecOps platform that is GitLab. Developers can address vulnerabilities in real time, avoiding those release delays. And what's most powerful is that our solution uniquely allows data to be collected from the requirement phase, so starting from the epic, milestone, issue, and then all the way to production. You can leverage this data to provide incremental checks along the way to ensure only the best code is merged and delivered to your customers. So I know this is a lot to take in all at once, but I want to go ahead and just dive into some of the GitLab workflow components to break down some of the terminology that may or may not be familiar to all, just to set a good foundation for all of us today. So GitLab uses terminology for its components that might be a little bit different or maybe similar to other systems that you might have used, but when I want to reference them, I want to make sure that you're aware of how we're referencing them from the GitLab context. I'll be referring to all these terms throughout today's webinar, and you'll become more familiar with them as I introduce you to the GitLab workflow. So the first component here is the project. So this is the core building block where work is organized, managed, tracked, and delivered to help the team collaborate and plan work in the form of issues. So within a project, we have what we call the repository as well. So if you're storing your source code within GitLab, which is obviously a common use case in GitLab, inside the project, you'll have a project repository. And other tools outside of GitLab that also do source control management, it might just be known as a repository. But within GitLab, you have the concept of a project, which also holds all of the issues, the work that's being tracked against that project repository, for example. So the work that needs to be done on the code base itself. Next, we have the group. The group is a collection of different projects and subgroups. They're really like folders within the GitLab DevSecOps platform. And other tools, a group might actually be called a project if the project was organizing different repositories and other tools. But in the GitLab terminology, we've got a group that essentially holds several projects that are related to that specific group. So a group could be your entire organization. So on our SaaS platform, you're commonly assigned the top level group that's maybe designated for the entire organization. Then you have projects within that top level group that represent the different code bases, maybe microservices that your organization are working on. But you could also organize that with subgroups. I'll go into the group hierarchy a little bit later, but just at a high level, a group is just a way to organize those projects and even subgroups of projects as well. Next, we have the issue. So an issue is part of a project, as I mentioned. It's a fundamental planning object where the team documents the use case in the description, discusses the approach, estimates the size and effort using the issue weight, tracks the actual time and effort through our time tracking, assigns work, and tracks progress. This is also known as a story or narrative and other tools. Next, we have the GitLab component of an epic. This is really a collection of related issues across different groups and projects to help organize by a specific theme. On our next page here, we've got the merge request. So this is, you know, the link between an issue and the actual code changes. It captures the design, implementation details, those code changes, the code that's being proposed in that feature branch, discussions within the merge request. So you'll have the developer speaking with people within the organization that might be reviewing the code, providing commentary, providing feedback, asking the developer who was proposing those changes to make additional changes or iterations within that feature branch. You've got approvals, so you can enforce merge request approvals, for example, or have them as optional to ensure you have that proper oversight on the specific code changes. And in the ultimate tier, you have also scan result policies, which essentially create these dynamic required merge request approval rules based on the vulnerability findings based on a scan tool that's been implemented. So for example, you can make sure that proper oversight is implemented from your security team to provide approval and block a merge based on the findings of a secret within your feature branch. And if a secret is accidentally committed, you can't merge that branch unless the security team has reviewed, provided feedback that the secret be removed, revoked, and rotated before that merge can actually happen. You've also got the testing that could happen within a merge request. So the CI pipeline, you know, essentially running the automation through the GitLab CI process that's handled within, built in within the DevSecOps platform. And as I mentioned, those security scans. Merge request is quite comprehensive. It's really the core of the GitLab kind of GitLab flow in terms of doing that review, having oversight on those specific changes that you might be introducing, and running the automation against your proposed code changes. And the merge request is also known as a pull request from other tools that you might have worked with for source control management. Next, we've got the label, which is used to tag and track work for a project or group and associate issues with different initiatives. I'll show you a little bit more in detail how that works a little bit later on in today's webinar. Next, we've got the board, which is a visual listing of projects and issues that are useful for teams to manage their backlog of work, prioritize items, and move issues to the team or specific stage in the product. Next, we've got the milestone and iteration. So there are two different features or capabilities here. Commonly, in the GitLab sense, you know, we utilize the milestones to signify, you know, all of the related functionality that would be part of our, you know, monthly release. So we've got a milestone for, you know, 16.4, 16.5, you know, for every specific minor release of GitLab, we've got a specific milestone to associate all of those issues that we're targeting for part of that release. And then iteration is commonly used when I speak to customers to kind of work against a sprint, right? So you could have an iteration that corresponds to your weekly or biweekly sprint or whatever the cadence of you know, sprints you have within your agile workflow. You can utilize the GitLab iteration to implement that more automatically, creating that iteration on a specific cadence and, you know, rolling over specific issues that aren't completed within a specific sprint to the next sprint, for example. So that's the functionality between the two, and it's also known as a release or sprint in other tools, for example. Finally, we've got the roadmap, which is essentially a visual representation of the various epics for a group on GitLab. Next, I want to take you through the GitLab hierarchy, right? So I mentioned the idea of a group within GitLab, as well as projects and even subgroups. So GitLab projects are housed within groups, as you can see here. You've got the commonly on, say, our SaaS platform, even a self-managed customer, you'll have, you know, a single top-level group. And then within that group, you'll have any number of either subgroups or projects, right? So subgroups could be a way for you to organize some of your projects based on the department or function of the software that you're building. Maybe, you know, your front-end team, your back-end team, and then you have their specific projects that fall within that specific subgroup, or, you know, the specific line of the business, right? You know, within GitLab, we have the customer success team, and then we have, you know, also the engineering team, for example. So we may have different subgroups within our organization as well. So permissions are inherited from the top down. So whenever you add users to the top level group and you assign them to a specific role based on our permissions and role structure, they will inherit that role and the resulting permissions all the way down. So if you're working with the concept of least privilege, you should be focusing on adding your users. You know, if you're adding them at the top level group, you want to give them the least, you know, the lowest role possible that would, you know, allow them to do their work, starting with that top level group, and then trickle down, and then bump up their role as necessary, either on the subgroup level based on their specific department or function that they work within, or even the project. So if they have elevated permissions just for that specific project, they want to be, you need to make them an owner, for example, or a maintainer. You can do that either at the subgroup or project level. Furthermore, labels and milestones created at that top group level are available to all of your subgroups and projects, so that way you can add kind of a common terminology to share across all of your subgroups and projects, so that those shared labels can be kind of maintained in one place, and then you have that common terminology of how to organize your content across all of your subgroups and projects. Next, I'm going to take you through a more detailed example of the GitLab workflow. Just a quick example here where you can essentially start with, you know, creating and discussing your work in a new issue. So the team creates a new issue. You know, you might apply what we giving you an example of a discussion label. And then the team just discusses using comments and threads in that issue. And we'll show you an example through your user interface in upcoming slides here. Then when the developer is ready to, you know, start having their code reviewed, they create that feature branch and start with a merge request. So the developer creates that merge request associated with their feature branch and assigns the issue to themselves. Then the backend team starts their work and the developer starts writing their code. And the developer starts, you know, adds that working on label to make it easier to identify that the work is in progress. They start committing those changes directly to the feature branch. And then the pipeline starts running and starts testing on that feature branch. The developer can look at the pipeline within the GitLab user interface and monitors those pipeline results. And you can also see that through the merge request widgets if you're concerned about, you know, potential security vulnerabilities and, you know, the quality of your code, for example, and that sort of thing. The backend team then changes the label to the frontend label so that the frontend team can start working on it. Then they start deploying the staging, right? So the frontend developer starts working on the issue, building out the frontend for the application. Then the developer assigns the issue to themselves, that frontend developer, and adds that working on label. The team reviews and refines the code. The team stages the code within that same CI pipeline. They can deploy that code to a staging environment. You know, we've got mechanisms to manually deploy to staging whenever it's ready. And then the team changes the label to staging. And after successful implementation, the team changes that label to ready. So the technical documentation comes in, adds documentation label. They start, you know, reviewing what the changes are, communicating with the team in the merge request, starts preparing the documentation. Marketing also adds the marketing label, and the technical team removes the docs label when that docs are done, the technical docs. And then when the marketing team is done preparing, you know, their work that they need to prepare for, you know, announcing this new feature, they remove their marketing label and add the production label. Then this is ready to go to production. So the release team merges the merge request after all the approvals are made, all the code reviews happen, and everybody's comfortable with it. And they deploy that feature to production, and release team closes the issue. So that's just a brief example of just walking you through one scenario of, you know, taking an idea, taking it through the merge request process, working on it, doing that code review, obviously, and then, you know, getting it ready to deploy it in production. But what does that look like in GitLab? So let me take a look at showing you how that works starting with the group overview. So here you can see we're in a top level group, and you can see all of the subgroups and projects underneath this group. Groups have the three dots icon, whereas projects have a book icon. So you can see that there, you know, the achievements row here is a group, and then projects here, like the Omnibus Mirror, CNG, are all projects. On the left, you can see all the areas you can navigate to within the specific group. Here, we've got a list of all the epics within a group. So an epic, as a reminder, is a collection of related issues across different groups and projects to help you organize by specific theme. You can search by epics using keywords or by filtering by a specific label. So here, we're looking at, you know, basically all of our epics here that are not confidential and have a label of priority 3. So you can see it's, you know, it's infinitely flexible when you're using labels within GitLab to allow you to create these kind of unique lists of content, you know, either the work that you're tracking within epics or even issues. So whether you've got a portfolio initiative, investments within the product that you need to focus on, a capability or feature, or simply a large story, I'd recommend using an epic to capture kind of large scale effort, to capture its description, the business case, and any data that could be pertinent to describe this large body of work, right? So each epic has a title and headline, as well as a body and description. And it could be as long or as short as you want, and you can kind of edit that over time. We've got a summary here. We've got kind of everything's formatted either through our WYSIWYG editor or through Markdown, the GitLab flavor Markdown. And so you could add things like images and bolded lists and, you know, all sorts of kind of rich information to kind of fully flesh out your epics. And you can also point out here that you can, you know, set a start date, a due date, you know, the different labels, for example, even specifying a specific color. And then if you're, if you're an ultimate customer, then you also have the availability to, you know, nest an epic within sub epics as well, or child epics. And that's what I'm going to go over next. So as you know, from an epic page at the group level, you can break an epic down into more discrete parts with either child epics or issues. So here on the epic page, you know, we've got a large epic kind of broken down into more discrete logical pieces for more individual or independent tracking. So you've got maybe like a larger scale license compliance effort and the license scanning effort. And then it's kind of broken down into more, you know, specific pieces of work that the team can more, it's more approachable for the team. So these are all hierarchical and dynamic, and you can always click to expand all of these lists of epics. The epics in this list view are designated by a stack of papers, and then the issues are designated by a single sheet of paper icon. As I mentioned, in Ultimate, you do have the capability of nesting child epics within or sub epics within a parent epic. And then if you're a premium customer, you're likely gonna start organizing your work just by issues within the epic itself. We've also got a health status that you can assign that's within the Ultimate tier. So you've got the green, yellow, and red numbers at the top of an epic to designate how many issues are on track, needs attention, or at risk. Next, we've got the group issues. So this is a list of all the issues within a group. So although issues belong to individual projects, this view shows all the issues in all the projects under this group. Similar to the epic view, this list can be filtered by keyword or by relevant metadata, such as author, assignee, milestone, label, or et cetera. You can also see this information about each issue in the list view, including labels, assignees, weight, associated merge requests, comments, and more. The labels are really, as I mentioned, infinitely flexible and can be used to identify the type of issue. You know, for example, it's either a bug, a feature request, or priority of the issue. It could be 1, 2, 3, or 4 if you've got kind of that scale of priority, or the product grouping. You know, we use that as well here at GitLab, where it could be related to the distribution group or the release, or, you know, so on. could be also related to, you know, user experience or backend and so on and so forth. So labels really can help you organize your issues any way that makes sense for your organization. So we've got a search capability on the issue list view. So this shows an example of doing a search using both a label and a milestone, filtering by a scope label and the upcoming milestone for GitLab. We also have here also, I think this was actually updated recently to make sure that we're showing a specific issue that's assigned to a specific person as well. And so, you know, commonly you can utilize this issue list view to just gather all the issues that are relevant to the task at hand, whether it's, you know, finding all the issues that are assigned to a specific developer on the team, the specific grouping of the team based on the label, and so forth. So you obviously you can combine these in any number of ways based on the search filters, including the author of the issue, not just the assignee of the issue, but the author, the iteration that it's in, if it's in the current iteration or the next iteration. So if you're working in sprints, you can search that way, as well as keyword searches based on the title and description. As you add additional search parameters and adjust the sorting, the URL in the address bar will be updated appropriately with an appropriate query added to it, so that you can save the same exact query and then save that in your bookmarks or share that in a Slack message, for example, and share that with one of your colleagues, just so they can get that exact list view that you started to create with the filters that you added in. So this shows the details of a given issue. We've got the title and description as well as the metadata on the right. Right above the title, you have the status of open or closed, indicating if the issue is still in kind of open to be worked on, or if it's been closed and either closed because the work has been completed or closed because it's no longer relevant, right? You can also see when the issue was created. We've got kind of like a relative date, but if you hover over it, you can see the exact date and time. Then you've got the original author of the issue, as well as their role in the project. So we've got Peter Liu here, and Peter's a owner within the project. Within the description of the issue, you can utilize Markdown, as I mentioned, to format your text, create sections, order and unorder lists, and checklists that can track the tasks that are needed for the issue to be closed. And we recently added that WYSIWYG editor to make it a little bit easier to edit the formatting as well. Some of the key points from the kind of metadata area, we've got assignees. So you saw there, we've had 5 assignees. This will kind of rotate again. You'll see those assignees one more time when we get back to the top. We also have the epoch that the issue belongs to directly on that metadata section. We've got all of the labels that have been assigned to organize this issue. If you click into any one of those labels, you'll go back to that issue list view and automatically apply that label as a filter. So you can kind of get a quick overview of all those issues within your project that have that label assigned to it. We've also got the milestone that the issue belongs to. So in this case, it's assigned to milestone 16.3. So when this screenshot was captured, we were, you know, targeting this issue for that specific release of GitLab in 16.3. We've also got the iteration that the issue belongs to. If you're working through that kind of agile sprint-based process, you can see if it's assigned to maybe the current sprint or the next sprint, for example. Then we've got the issue weight. So issue weight is a way for you to essentially track kind of the relative difficulty, the estimate of how long the issue might take, just from a whole positive number perspective, right? So after you add in or assign a weight to an issue, you can see that being added up for all the issues in a list on an issue board or on the milestone page as a total sum of the issue weight. So you can kind of see, you know, the amount of work that's being planned when you're working through issue boards, if you've got a more of a Kanban method of managing work, or if you're working through a release through milestones, you can see how much work has been completed through that sum of the issue weight of, say, closed issues that were targeted for that specific milestone. Again, as I mentioned, the weights are whole positive numbers, and common patterns to assign to a weight could be the Fibonacci sequence or even whole numbers assigned aligned to t-shirt sizes. So, you know, small, medium, large. So it could be 1, 3, 5, for example, whatever makes sense for your organization. So it'll be a way for you to track that relative difficulty or how long you can estimate, you know, the size of that issue to be completed. And you've got the due date, self-explanatory there. Time tracking, you can see the estimated time that's needed to complete an issue and how much time was spent so far. And to enter and remove time tracking data, you've got to utilize quick actions within the comments field of an issue. So quick action is essentially, you got a forward slash and you type in the name of a quick action. It's just a quick way to trigger functionality within GitLab. You've got a quick action to essentially set the estimated time to work on an issue, and as well as tracking issue. As you start working on an issue, you can set the time that you've spent on an issue as well. All right, and then finally, we've got health status, as I mentioned, is the ultimate feature to determine whether that feature or that issue is on track, needs attention, or at risk. So to collaborate and track development of a user story, if you scroll down on an issue, we'll see all the associated merge requests, related issues, and discussions. You see that there in the linked items and related merge requests. You can have threaded conversations and can mention other users to bring attention or request or action on an issue. And each issue or comment can be reacted to via an emoji. So we use this at GitLab to track support from team members, community members, and users of GitLab, such as yourself, and our customers on issues that have, you know, the most upvotes and thumbs up, for example, reactions to help influence our product prioritization. So here we got an example of that that group discussion. So you've got, you know, starting with, you know, this thread here, you got Dov, you know, suggesting some changes here, what he's suggesting there. Then we've got a follow on of other members of the team kind of responding at mentioning that conversation. On the left-hand side, as I mentioned, we've got the kind of widget within the issue that shows the linked items, you know, related issues, issues that are blocking the current issues, related merge requests, you know, feature branches that are contributing to the changes that are being proposed in this issue, as well as those are all clickable and are links to the relative issues or related merge requests, for example. And as I mentioned, that right-hand side is that discussion area. So I've kind of alluded to boards. And so boards are at the group level. So one way to see a board is at the group level. And boards give you the visibility or the ability to visualize and organize issues for all issues within that group. And boards can be filtered similar to the issue list. You can have columns in the board based on label, milestone, assignee, and more. So it's really kind of flexible based on how you want to organize your work and move work to different stages within your organization. So you could have multiple boards and switch easily between them using that drop-down menu here. So you've got the triage kind of drop-down here. So this is a triage board, but you can imagine maybe you've got different workflows based on different, you know, departments or members of the team that might be working on all the body of work that might be contained within a group. So you can have multiple boards and switch between them quite easily. So this board is actually at the group level and shows all issues within all projects underneath the specific group. You can have a board specifically at the project level, and that gives you the ability to look at the issues and organize the issues based on the project itself. But if you want to have this kind of higher level overview, you could do it at the group level as well. So with merge requests, you get a complete view of all aspects of the change being made to the code base. You could see the latest pipeline progress. You can review and approve the changes, and you could review the security scan results all in one place. So as I mentioned, in a merge request, you've got different merge request widgets that show you the results of your pipeline automation, the CI process, right? So code quality scanning, security scanning, your dependency scanning, and the licenses that are detected as part of that dependency scan. So you can review all of this in one place. GitLab makes it really easy to start and track the progress of a code review. You can add general comments directly in the source code at a specific line and start a review that way. Or you can just generally add comments at the bottom of the merge request. So you can either do a review just generally as an overview of all the changes as a whole, kind of summarizing everything and what you'd like to see change, or individually at the kind of individual line level within based on the changes on specific files, for example. So this is just a brief overview of GitLab CI/CD. If you're really interested in getting more deep into GitLab CI/CD, we're going to have two different webinars focusing on GitLab CI/CD, an intro to it, as well as an advanced section. And then we also offer that that hands-on workshop. So if you're looking to get more hands-on and learning more in practice, definitely recommend you check out our webinar calendar and sign up for our workshop on that. So with GitLab CI/CD, just to get everybody on the same foundation of what it means, CI/CD is continuous integration and continuous delivery or deployment based on your specific organizational workflow. GitLab CI/CD allows for built-in automated builds and tests to be run on your code as you make those changes. So as I mentioned, you know, you could have this pipeline running automatically on every commit to your code base, on every new feature branch. The workflow is really flexible on your needs, however you want to run those pipelines, and you can customize that as needed. We talk about that a lot more in our upcoming webinars, and as well as the work hands-on workshop. So I definitely encourage you to sign up for those. CI/CD encourages collaboration across all departments and makes code creation management easy, as well as provides you know, specific benefits, such as allowing for early error detection, reduce integration problems, and increase team speed and efficiency. And with CD, it allows you to deliver your value based on the features that you're developing more quickly and more often, and ensures every change is releasable. This view shows labels at the group level. It can be filtered by keyword to find the relevant labels, as well as showing, you know, for example, you know, all the priority labels in the group, and using what we call the scoped label feature that lets you create a name value pair for labels so that only one of each category can be applied at each time. So you can see, I mentioned priority, but in this screenshot here, we've got the group scope label. So when this kind of rotates back, you can see there's group global search, and then there may be another group below that that corresponds to another group. And what that means is, you know, when you apply that label to, for example, an issue or an epic, only one group can be assigned to that issue or epic. So we'll have different groups assigned and responsible for that issue or epic because it only relates to the work that they are leading within GitLab. And so the scope label kind of creates that name value pair. So you can only apply that to, you know, a single category one at a time. And the labels can be used to organize lots of different things within GitLab, such as epics, issues, and merge requests. So we've got the milestone view here at the group level. So milestones are a way to group issues and merge requests together in a block of time. So as I mentioned, in GitLab, we utilize that block of time as the release that we're planning for the current month or upcoming releases in future months. So milestones have a defined start and end date and include any number of issues and merge requests. So here we see all the milestones for the group and any milestones created for projects in the group. You get a summary view of the number of issues and merge requests in the milestone and how far along it is. And you can drill into these to see burn up or burn down and burn up charts associated with the milestone to see your progress as the team completes their work over time for either the current milestone or future milestones as you're planning that work. I want to share some easy ways to navigate within GitLab. So there's lots of ways to navigate. You've got the obviously the URL. At the very top, you see that URL change depending on what view you're looking at in GitLab. And you can share that URL, as I mentioned, to anybody on your team to get them to that specific place that you were just looking at, right? So on the left, you could switch to view different types of data within the specific group or project that you're currently viewing. You've got, you know, everything separated out into the different stages of our product, the different functionality that's collected within those stages. So planning, code for like the source code management, you know, branches and looking at the repository. You've got the build stage, so looking at your pipelines, the secure stage, looking at the vulnerability report and the security dashboard, so on and so forth. And then at the top center, right below that URL, is the breadcrumbs. So that shows you exactly where you are in the group and project hierarchy. So as I mentioned, you could have, you know, a top level group. So this is the top level group of GitLab.org. Then we've got the GitLab planning subgroup beneath that. And then we've got the release planning project specifically underneath that GitLab planning subgroup. And depending where you are, that URL is always changing. So that way you can more easily share that with other team members. So navigating back to the group, depending on where you're at. So if you've gotten really nested within, you've got a really complex hierarchy, you can utilize those breadcrumbs to navigate back up however you want, either to a subgroup within that hierarchy or back to the top level group. So we're going to the incubation in engineering subgroup that lives beneath the GitLab.org top level group. From the group page, if you need to create a new project, you can click either the new project button to create a new project, and then we'll have options to create a new project from scratch, a blank project, create one from a template, so you can utilize the built-in GitLab templates, or specify a template within your group hierarchy so that all of your projects can kind of start off from a specific template that your organization has defined for the types of projects that you're building. And if you're a self-managed customer, you can create templates that could be created from at the entire instance level. So any group, any project created within any of those groups in that instance can create a project from a template. You could also import a project as well if you're importing from another source code SCM tool, another GitLab instance, you know, other options there. So that was just kind of a brief overview of everything within the GitLab platform. I think we just touched on several different things. And I want to make sure that we let you know how we can help you be more successful. So GitLab offers lots of different ways to maximize the value of your investment through training, access to subject matter experts like myself. And I'm also joined by Rashid now with him on the customer success engineering team and other members of the customer success team that can provide you with best practices. So starting with our self-paced learning and certification process, we've got a free learning management system that can be accessed at levelup.gitlab.com. We've got several courses that let you go really deep into learning GitLab and several different use cases from a project manager's perspective or persona to a developer's persona, developing automated pipelines to a security professional and how to secure your software development process. Those are all free courses that you could take at levelup.gitlab.com. And if you've taken those courses and you want to get certified within a specific area of GitLab, we do offer paid certifications as well through that same platform. Next, we've got private instructor-led training. So much more in depth than what we're able to offer you on this monthly cadence so through our introductory presentations and hands-on workshops. And this is multi-day trainings led by our professional services team that are personalized for your specific organization. So we have one example there, the GitLab CI/CD training. You'll be getting a copy of today's deck along with some additional resources to get more familiar with our catalog of private instructor-led training as well. And as I mentioned, we do have our monthly cadence of webinars and workshops that we offer to all of our customers. Those are free. You can sign up at any time to get more of an introductory presentation on GitLab and our several use cases that I mentioned, as well as those hands-on workshops to really dig into some hands-on exercises, be led by a member of the customer success team and getting more familiar. And you still have access to ask questions during those webinars and workshops to kind of help you get more familiar with those different use cases. And then finally, you can engage with a member of the customer success team if you're eligible. We've got members of the customer success engineering, customer success management team that you could schedule time with, depending on your eligibility. We also reach out periodically. And if you're assigned a customer success manager, you may have a cadence of calls with them. So definitely look to schedule a time with a member of our customer success team to make sure that we can help answer your questions more specifically in a one-on-one format. Another tool that's not mentioned here is priority support. So if you're a GitLab Premium or Ultimate customer, you're paying for that specific GitLab subscription, you are entitled to priority support from our GitLab team. So our support engineers can help you navigate our documentation, for example, implementing CI/CD and adding in our vendor templates to improving your security posture and shifting security left. We've got a scope of support as well as how to get help. And you can also inquire with the support team to connect you with your sales representative if you don't know who they are, as well as scheduling time for a customer success engagement if needed. I've got time for a Q&A, but I also want to launch a poll just to get your feedback on how today's session was. Let me go ahead and get that brought up here. Appreciate all of your feedback and seeing how we did today and how we can seek to improve more webinars and workshops in the future. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer those live in today's webinar. But if not, really appreciate you all of you joining today and look forward to hosting you for future webinars and workshops hosted by the customer success team. Right, sounds good. I don't think I see any additional questions here. Well, appreciate everyone's time. Have a great rest of your week, and we'll see you soon for the next webinar or workshop. Take care.